Hello, everybody. Thank you for inviting me. I think it's a great opportunity to share with you the historical and recent thoughts about the impacts of climate change on the Wadden Sea. Yeah. Oh. There we are. So this is how the Wadden Sea looks from space. You see a vast array of islands stretching out over 600 kilometers of coastline. And what you can also see, there's between the islands and the land, there is this grayish area. And there is a stamp on this picture. The stamp, as Ines already told you, of being a World Heritage. And there's a reason for that, meaning that we have the Golden Medal for natural areas in the world. So if we look at this map, you can see that it's not only in the Netherlands, it's also stretching out from the Netherlands to Germany, to Denmark. And as Ines also already indicated, it's very close to Leeuwarden. So it's only 20 kilometers as the crow flies from here, so you can visit it easily. I told you about the barrier islands. I told you about the tidal flats. You see them here in brown. But also very typical is the so-called tidal basins and, very important, the freshwater inputs. So this is a more detailed picture of the Dutch part of the Wadden Sea. Here you see also different depth, and basically the tidal flats are here in brown, yellow colors. And if you can read the depth, you can see that they are located between plus 1 meter and minus 1 meter, according to this Dutch ordinance level, where we base all the heights in the Netherlands upon. What you also see are these dotted lines and these numbers, and these dotted lines are not dikes or dams, but these are kind of a division as we make them in the Wadden Sea, and we need this information later for the rest of the talk. Which are called tidal basins. Basically, when it's high tide, it's all water, so everything is connected. But when it's low tide, these systems are disconnected, and they have their own characteristics, and also, from that, their own responses to climate change. Freshwater inputs. Here you see, so this area is continuously fed by fresh water, mainly via these main rivers. There's a lot of fresh water coming in. So from Lake Isel, you can see that it's 380 square meter per second on average, here. And then ranging up to the Elbe, which is the largest river, or giving the largest input, up to 860 cubic meter per second on average every year. And these characteristics are base to the ecosystem and also to its vulnerability to climate change. And it became a World Heritage. And so far I showed you mainly the abiotic characteristics, but of course a very important reason for becoming a World Heritage is the biology in this area. And just to give you two examples, so one reason is it's very important value of this area for migratory birds. So birds that breed up high up north in the tundra, and they overwinter down south along the coast of Africa, they need this area as a stopover and to fuel themselves and to enable them to make this very across these very large distances. One of the other very important functions of this area is that it is a nursery for juvenile fish. If you look at the life cycle, this is the life cycle of plaice, a flatfish you can also find on your plate. It's a very tasty flatfish, but it needs the Wadden Sea in order to come up to your plate, because you have the adults, and they live in the North Sea. There they reproduce eggs, the eggs turn into larvae, and the larvae are transported by water and also swim a bit to end up in areas in the coastal, shallow coastal areas like the Wadden Sea. And there they settle to the bottom, and then they get this strange, they still look like fish when they are larvae, but here they start to change their shape, and they go to the bottom and stay there for 1 to 3 years, another to be large enough, swim back to the North Sea, and become part of the adult population. So that's also a reason that this is an important area. And if you want to know more about this area, of course, the first thing you should do is go there, but the second best is watch one of these two movies on the area, and the one What is mainly about biology, and the other one, Silence of the Tides, also takes the interaction between the beauty and the people who live there into account. We cherish this. We cherish the way it looks, the way the plants and animals are supported by the system, but it was a very close call. Here I show you some history. So, only 100 years ago, these were the plans to change this area. And we had a so-called Zuiderzee, was a very open estuary from the River IJssel up to in the North Sea. And there were these plans to close it off and use the area south of this dike for freshwater support and for gaining extra agricultural land. This scenario became reality. We know that the Afsluitdijk was closed in 1932, and most of these polders are indeed realized. There was another scenario on the table, only 50 years ago. That was a scenario that we would close off most of the Wannensee, and then turn most of the area into land to grow potatoes. These are the yellow areas. Partly close it off to have another freshwater basin, which is the light blue, and only a very small part, so just south of the Texel, would still be a marine estuarine system. And this almost was realized. So what happened was, part of this plan was to close off the former Lauwerszee, and that was the Lauwers turned into Lauwersmeer by constructing a dam in 1969. But there was already at that time people were thinking about there is more to the Wannensee than just sand and water. There's also something that we value, and this was also the time that the Wadden Vereniging was founded, where people collected and said, this is not what we want for this area. We want to keep the beauty of the area. And they managed to do so, and they were rewarded then in the end of becoming this area being a World Heritage. But now there are different scenarios on the table, and we don't know what's happening, but I will try to share with you some thoughts which way we might be heading. And we just got the new IPCC report out, the physical science basis, and it talks about 5 different scenarios depending on how we, basically, what we do as a population, human population of on Earth. So there are 2 that say we will decline fast in the amount of emissions of carbon dioxide. There is one, the yellow one, that says, okay, we will not do this immediately, but we will get there. And the 2 red ones are the way it's almost continuous as we're doing now. So what are then the consequences for, possible consequences for this area? And basically also for other coastal areas in the world. Let's first look at sea level rise. So on top you see the prediction by this IPCC report. You see again the different scenarios that they've built, and you see this increase for the mean global rise in sea level. That is ranging between 30 centimeters and 60 centimeters, adding to the present sea level. The bottom graph is something really zoomed in into this area, and I put the sources there so you can all find this information back. And that says, for the different scenarios, probably the Wannensee will be behaving more or less the same. And then, depending on the scenarios, the rise will be 30 to 70 centimeters by 2100. But what does it mean? What would then be the impact for the ecosystem? Let's first go back to the birds. So the birds that come here can only feed on the tidal flats, they only feed from the tidal flats, and they can only feed there if the tidal flats are submerged. And that is then, you see that on the right-hand corner, and this is where they spread out over the tidal flats, and they really need the time to be there to get enough food and not starve. And if you looked at to the right hand of this graph, when the water comes, they have to leave. You already see them. When they have to leave, it just has to do with the shortage of the legs. They have to leave, and then they go to places that are still, when the tidal flats are submerged, they go to places where it's still dry, and they just digest, they rest, they interact, and they basically wait until the canteen is open again. And if you want to see how fast it goes, I would like to point you out to this Watlas, where you can see live, they track birds, and you can see live directly on your computer, on your mobile telephone, where a lot of those birds are, and you see them coming, changing their behavior in time. And in the middle, you see this tidal curve, and there's also something important to mention here. You see the black line is the astronomical tide, so that is predicted, I don't know how far and in the future, because that's relatively easy. That has to do with the sun and the moon, and you can predict that. But basically, it's never that tight if you go out, because there is this addition of the wind. And if you see, for example, October 3, so midnight, you see the red line is much lower than the black line, meaning there was a lot, probably meaning there was a lot of easterly wind blowing out the water out of the sea, and then you get a decrease in the sea level during low tide. And yesterday you see that the red line during high tide is much higher. Probably we had a change in wind, western wind, and then the water is pushed in, and then the water levels are higher. So what happens if there would be sea level rise? If you look over here, so we just talked about the birds that change between feeding and resting, and the time they have for feeding has to do at the level where the tidal flats are, and then the curve of the tidal cycle on top of it. And basically assume that the tidal flats are at the level of zero here, so and being the Dutch ordinance level, Then if the water is lower, they fall dry. If the water is higher, there is water on top of these tidal flats. If it's low, they can feed, and if it's high, they have to go away there and have to rest. So the brown hours are basically, the brown parts in this figure are basically the periods that they can feed, and in this case, that would be approximately 6 hours per tide. And then if the tidal flats would stay the same, but the water levels would go up, then you can immediately see what the impact is. There will be a longer time the flats will be submerged, a shorter time they will be emerged, and they have less time to feed. So if we take this, this higher scenario, plus 60 centimeters, you see that the feeding time goes from 6 hours to approximately 2 hours per tide, which is a lot for these birds. But luckily in the Wadden Sea, it's a sandy environment. And what we have observed historically, and also what we expect for the future, if the sea level rises, then the tidal flats appear to be growing with the sea level. And if you look at this picture, you can see historically, so starting 1935, these measurements, so after the Afsluitdijk was closed, you see that on average, and this is then the values are in millimeter per year, the tidal flats went higher and they were able to grow because there was already a background sea level rise. They were able to grow with this sea level. Only for this tidal basin Eierland that there appears to be a net erosion, so losing sediment. But there is a limit to the rates, and we're talking about rates, so we're not talking about amounts, but rates, there is a limit in this rate that these tidal flats can grow with sea level rise. And some calculations have been made for the different tidal basins, and these were the results. So you see here in the rows the different scenarios and the different years, and you see here in the columns you see the tidal basins again, and everything that is red is exceeding this critical rate. So translating in what we expect to be happening, if you go to this RCP 4.5 scenario and you look at the tidal basin of Vlie, so number three in the picture, you see that already in 2030 this tidal basin is no longer able to cope with the increases sea level rise. Meaning in 2030, in this scenario, this year, the tidal flats start to drown. It's not like they will drown from one day to another, but they will start to decrease in size. And there's another thing that will impact the ecosystem of the Wadden Sea. That is how we deal with the threats that we are facing as a result of sea level rise. So this is a picture taken from this report by Deltares, and they say there are four scenarios how we can act to protect ourselves against sea level rise. We can close it off and we can just enlarge our dikes and our dams to a much higher level. We can let the sea in but protect the areas where we live in. We can move seawards and building new islands and all kinds of infrastructure, or we retract and let water come in. And you can easily see, because you saw already, remember the first satellite picture, it is a coastal area. So everything you will do, whichever scenario you will take, it will impact the ecosystem of the Wadden Sea. And it's not like something of the future. We ask a colleague of ours to come with an overview, and all the dots in the different colors are already projects that are already just finished or being built or being planned, and based on one of those four scenarios. So we are already working very hard in different ways. And what you can also see, it's not like we have chosen for one scenario for the Wadden Sea, but each color is a different scenario. So basically, a lot of organizations choose for another scenario very close to each other. And yeah, we wonder then also, will it enforce the different axes and force, or will they weaken each other? This is also something that really needs our attention. So, sea level rise, it will happen. We probably will not be able to stop it. And it will have an impact on the Wadden Sea, and in some areas we expect that to be happening within the next 10 years. Local wind is important, as I showed you, the difference between the astronomical and the actual tide, meaning that we also have to consider possible changes in wind direction and wind speed. They might have even a higher impact than the global sea level rise, and the new infrastructures to combat the sea level rise. They might be threats, but for example, remember the thing of retraction, it might also give solutions or possibilities to strengthen the ecosystem. Up to increase in temperature. You've probably seen this one. Also from the new IPCC report. And what you can see, warming everywhere, and mostly land compared to oceans, and mostly poles compared to the rest of the area. But also we know, for example, it's not so visible, but especially the North Sea and the Baltic Sea, they are a bit surrounded by land, so these are also the seas that are most prone to fast warming. And we can also see it in the temperature measurements. So here you see a long-term time series, which is so valuable to have a grip on what's actually happening. And it started already in 1860. At that time, someone going to the water, taking a bucket of water and putting a thermometer in, and now we got this automated smart measurements, but still the temperature. And you see already in the top graph this increase in temperature. And in the bottom graph, you see also this very warm year of 2018. So we're not talking about air temperature, but really about water temperature and how much higher it was in summer, but also remarkably that it was relatively low in spring. So this was really a heat wave in 2018, and we saw a lot of impacts of this heat wave on the ecosystem. And one of the things we see generally happening due to the impacts, due to the increase of temperature, is that the family of animals and plants living in the water sea is generally growing. We got a lot of new species coming in, just from the south, swimming in, being transported in, and then being able to survive. And at this moment, also species are getting out, going to the north, but their number is much lower than the new species coming in. So basically, the global warming, or at least local warming, leads to this increase in biodiversity. But I'm not sure if that is a good thing due to the reason why this happens. And going a bit into more detail of the fish, the water sea, I told you, so the young plaice, for example, the flesh fish is coming in and then stays here a couple of years and then is going out. And this period that it stays in, it used to stay here for 3 years, doesn't happen anymore. We saw that this period that they stay here declined from three to two to one, and now we mostly got only the very young fish being here for a year, getting out again. And one of the reasons could be that it's just getting too warm in this area. So what we did here, if we compare 2 years, so 2010 and 2011, we had temperatures of these years, and we compared those temperatures with, say, kind of growth-reducing optimal temperatures for this specific two flatfish species. And red is there is growth reduction because it's just too hot, and blue is there is no growth reduction due to too high temperatures. And you already see 2010, which was a warm year, but not as warm as 2018, you already see that large part of this area is no longer suited for this fish due to high temperatures. Timing is also, we have a lot of evidence that timing changes. We living in a seasonal environment, meaning that a lot of, say, reproductions happens in a certain time of the year. Take, for example, the birds, they all breed in May. We have something exactly similar also with fish and with all kinds of animals in the water and sea. And a lot of these things are tuned to each other. So, for example, if we take the left one, this used to be the historical situation. There is this bloom of algae somewhere in spring, and then immediately there is this so-called zooplankton, little shrimp-like animals that start to increase and feed on this plankton, and then after that, then the juvenile fish used to come in and feed on the zooplankton. What now happens is that the reproduction starts early in the North Sea, meaning that these young fish come in earlier, but they're basically too early. They are too early to take profit of this historical succession of phytoplankton, zooplankton, and then they feed, meaning that they do not find enough food. I will give you an example on birds just in a minute. What we also see, that's also a very strange thing, is on average, worldwide, the temperature also leads to, especially then, like fish, which are cold-blooded animals, they start to shrink. And that probably has something to do with the oxygen exchange. Again, the chemical reaction, oxygen. So this is what happened. And they cannot longer support a large body, so there's this selection, and we only end with the smaller ones. And you can see this all over the world. And if you look into detail in the area where we are now, you see there is expected something between 20 and 50% reduce in size on average. And this is the example in birds, because now something happens that goes much further than the area we live in. So this is an observation done from a breeding bird that breeds up north and that overwinters in the west coast of South Africa. And what they found is, like I just showed, this mismatch. There used to be that the eggs would hatch at the moment just after the snow melted, because once the snow melts, then there is this bloom of insects and all the little chicks can feed on those insects. And what happened now, the birds came there at the same period as they used to do, but the snow was already melted, the insects were already, most of them were gone, and there were shortage of food. In this case, the chicks did not die in high densities, but they didn't grow as fast as they used to do. So they ended up with smaller chicks, which had to go fly back to their overwintering area in the west coast of Africa. And what were the consequences? So these birds feed from animals that are basically burrowed into the sediment. And they can take as much food as the length of their beak, because they probe into the sediment until the end of the beak, and then they take, like these little shellfish you can see here, they get those and they swallow them as a whole, and that's their basic food provisioning. Here you can see on the right plot, what now happened is, because they were smaller, the beak was also smaller. And when they came into the overwintering area, they could not reach their favorite food, because all the different species are at different depth. And they used to, and they had to switch to another food source, which was less nutritious for them, and then including even seagrass, which is growing at the surface. And then they starved, and then they died. So there was this really teleconnection, something that happening far up north had this implication far down south, at the other side of the equator. So temperature rise, what do we see? What do we see? We have plenty more of examples. We see this change in geographical distributions. Species move north, or like the fish, probably move to deeper waters, which are cooler. We see this decoupling in the timing, in the seasonal timing. We see a lot of those cold-blooded animals getting smaller. And we see even impacts that cross about thousands of kilometers. And again, if you want to read more, we have several reports on the website of the Wadden Academy. And last but not least, changes in precipitation. Again, a picture from the IPCC where you see these expectations, and it is projected to increase over the high latitudes, but decrease for parts of the subtropics, and on average the area where we live probably has to deal with increasing frequency of droughts. And we're already working on it heavily. So also here we had a few talks. So how do we deal with freshwater management with our eyes on the land? So we used to have this old strategy. So we would hold a bit of water, we would store a bit of water, but most of the water would be discharged into the sea. And we're shifting to a new strategy. We want to hold more water, we want to store more water, and we want to keep the discharge, except of these periods of heavy rainfall, but we want to keep the discharge to the sea as limited as possible, because we need our water on land. And you see how much money is invested, and probably that you can translate that into all the plans and strategies and infrastructures that will be built to do this. But what could then the implications be for the Wadden Sea? Looking back at the picture that I already showed you, the Wadden Sea relies also on freshwater. It is a coastal estuarine freshwater. Estuarine system where freshwater is a very important reason that this area is as rich as it is rich now. In addition to these four large rivers, if we go into detail again for the Dutch part of the Wadden Sea, there's many freshwater points along our coastline. What could be the consequences then if we would reduce this discharge of water into the area? For one, if there would be less discharge, there would be a lower input of nutrients into this area, especially phosphate is limiting for algae growth. So we could expect a lower algal production. The second one, if there would be less discharge, you probably also saw the satellite images of Lake Isel during an algal bloom. It's really full of algae. So if we would have less discharge, there would also be less input of freshwater algae. And we recently found that's also food for animals. For example, mussels and cockles, they also feed. Half of the diet consists of these freshwater algae. So there will also be less room for shellfish. And if there's less discharge, there will be less salinity gradients in the water sea, and that will make it far more difficult, even impossible, for migratory fish to find. They come from the North Sea, they have to find these very small holes that we still have in our dikes and dams, and they need this mapping of these salinity gradients to find their way. So once we close everything off, probably that will it make them impossible to find their way inland. Another thing is, this is then a map that I took from people working on land, on fish migration, and they mapped here all the bottlenecks that fish encounters. So all the red ones are the bottlenecks still to be solved, the green ones are the ones they're working on, and the blue ones used to be bottlenecks, but they have been solved. And being solved often has to do with removing dams in river. But what you also see in this new strategy is people trying to get back all these dams into rivers. And that might even then turn the blue ones into red ones again. So, precipitation, less freshwater discharge, less nutrients, less algae, a distortion of the pathways for migratory fish. All the measures inland to keep the water in might also affect the migratory fish, which use part of their life staying in the water sea, but also part inland. And what we also expect, and this is then probably because we are investing at short notice so much money, that probably this one is the one that we would like to put our attention on and make sure that all solutions that are found and are necessary, I'm convinced of that, but also take the impacts on the water and sea system itself into account, not only with the back to the sea, but also looking at the sea. And of course, it's difficult. If it would be easy, it would already have been done. What we can do, at least as a Water Academy, we can help, and like you're doing as well, to have the scientific basis on the table, to have this in this way aiding to the social discussion, and we have to be transparent because decisions, tough decisions, have to be made, and let's try to make them as transparent as we can. And this is an article that really struck me. I don't know if you read it, by a writer who also writes columns in the local newspaper. And he said, it is difficult for us to take these decisions which will impact generations ahead, because we can hardly imagine who those people are. But, he says, they will be there and they should be taken into account. So, let's work together and let's try to keep the golden glow of the World Heritage that we all share. Thank you.
Doet het al, yeah. Thank you very much for your presentation. Now I will first give the audience opportunity to ask a question. We have a microphone here, microphone there. Everybody who wants to ask questions, move to the first row, but we can forgive if anyone in the back wants to ask a question. I see no questions yet. Then, there, in the middle.
The most difficult to reach with a microphone.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. Thank you for your presentation. I have two questions.
Who are you? We cannot see you.
Sorry. My name is Steven. I'm a water technology student here at Vessis in my first year.
Okay.
And I don't know if you attended yesterday, but we had also a presentation about the hydrogen economy in Delfzijl, where an area of land is designed to be used for hydrogen production. And I was curious if you also know what the impact of the Wadden Sea ecology is on that development. That's my first question. And the second question is that for the hydrogen economy, a lot of windmills will be used. But these windmills, of course, kill also many, many birds. And I was curious what the implication of that is for the migration of the birds, and if that's also taken into account.
Okay, thank you for the question. So the first question is a bit difficult to answer for me. So I will not respond to that because I'm not familiar enough with this case. But the second
what will happen is that 15 million cubic meters of water less in the Waddenzee. Is that a lot? No, I don't think so. Huh?
Oh, then we have to do the math very, very fast.
Yeah. I'm too tired for that. So,
okay.
But I think it's the biggest consequence.
We can talk about this later. Then you inform me a bit better about this case, and we can have this discussion. But the second one, the windmills. So basically, the idea is to put the windmills in the North Sea, and it will be decided probably the first step this week. And then there is this discussion. So, of course, something will happen in the North Sea, but that's also difficult because we concentrate on the Wadden Sea area. We just wrote an advice to the parliament on that. So I can refer you to that, but the basic idea is what happened is there are ideas to put these windmills in the North Sea and also to have them connected to a station on land. And what happened then is they said, okay, but we have to have a cable and maybe also later, at the later stage, this hydrogen pipe to it. So then is the question, how should we proceed with that and what are the impacts of that? And there are different trajectories being proposed. And what we made is a kind of a weighing schedule how you could approach it and do this in a transparent way because it will have impact. But we also need to make this energy transition and that these are the things, these are political decisions and yeah, so these are decisions of us all. What we did at least is to get as much information as we could on the table which is relevant to make a fair decision.
Could you also then decide what is the best place to put the windmills?
I'm very happy that you're asking because if you look from the Wadden Sea, you could decide. Look at what now happened is North Sea, a big commotion. Everything was arranged, and then here was a big fight. Who will get the energy? And then later on the Wadden Sea. But if you say Wadden Sea is a world heritage and we should treasure and look at it like that, then you could have the other way around. You say, okay, it's a Wadden Sea, and there's also this agenda for the Wadden Sea area. We need a kind of areas where we concentrate these things, and then decide on that first, and then see, okay, if this is being decided, and this is also part of advice, then look where could the windmills be best placed in the North Sea, and which location should the electricity come to.
Poor birds. Or they are chopped, or they are drowned.
Yeah.
This is answer your question. You have more questions.
One more.
Okay, one more.
Relating to the second one, in your presentation, you also mentioned the scenario of the IPCC that takes into account the RCP of 8.5, like the most extreme scenario. However, like the recent measurements have already shown that the most extreme scenarios of the IPCC are very unlikely to happen. So in what way, what would, in your opinion, be the balance that we have to strike between preserving the ecology of the Wadden Sea compared to making the infrastructure there to harvest the hydrogen from the wind farms? How much ecology can we destroy for quote-unquote hydrogen?
Exactly. So I cannot decide on how the balance ends up. The
if
only
you
thing
if you were a minister, just like Levy yesterday, he wants to be a minister too.
Yeah, exactly. But of another department. Eh? Yeah. So I cannot give you the answer. The only thing that we can do is put this information on the table. Say, okay, if you do it like this, that will cost you so many birds or people jobs.
If you were the boss, what would you do?
Yeah, but I'm. You mean the boss of the Wannensee?
Of the boss of the Netherlands.
The thing is, then I wouldn't not still could not decide because we see the Wannensee as an entity stretching out to Germany and Denmark. So.
Yeah. Okay. Hello. Maybe it's better you're not going to be in the ministry. I have another question. So you said that because I was surprised of that at it sounded that you would like to have more phosphate in the water. And we, as environmental technologists, are doing everything to get the phosphate out of the water.
Yeah.
So you don't want that. You want us to put it back into the water?
Or
take it out of water and then dump it into the water?
No, this is... So I did my PhD in the time that we had this eutrophication. So we had the surplus of nitrogen and phosphate.
Me too.
Yeah. Okay. but on a different subject, I suppose.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And then I was so happy to see because it was a surplus. We were experiencing a lot of impacts, unwanted impacts, much more than you also would expect in an area like this. And then I was so happy that the Department of Infrastructure and Environment then was able to reduce this amount of input of nutrients. But what happened, you probably know, it's more difficult for nitrogen than for phosphate. So what happened then is that we have this background balance of 16:1. We are now in a phase that we still have, we didn't manage to get nitrogen as far back as phosphate, so phosphate is really limiting. So we also have a shift in stoichiometry, the ratio between these two, and probably this has an impact on algae. So, but where is the optimum? I don't know. But if we would further reduce and no longer have phosphate in the sea, it will have an impact on the algae for sure. Yeah.
Yeah, but what we are doing now is developing technologies to take it out of the IJsselmeer, right? To take it out of lakes, to further improve the efficiency of phosphate removal in water treatment plants. So the phosphate discharge is going to go down, and the farmers they will have to limit the phosphate discharge. Yeah. And of course, for the next 100 years, the groundwater will be polluted with phosphate, but then probably disappears. So
if that would happen and we would end up with a kind of a background what you would expect in the coastal area with a good balance between nitrogen, which is also very important, so we also have to put a lot of effort in nitrogen.
So if nitrogen goes down, then you're happy with less phosphate?
It's not like I'm happy with it, but I was thinking what would then be the reference of being a natural concentration, and that's something, and if you go below, you're impacting it. But we have the surplus of phosphate because we took it out of the mines and we used it on the land, so that is still coming there.
Yeah, but it seems like indeed unnatural. Huh? It seems to be that the natural situation was much less hetero.
Yes. So we try to reconstruct the couple, but you have to go very much back in time to find it. But what is the natural condition then? That's one question. And the other question is...
But does that mean that like 200 years ago we had less birds in the water, say, because there was less nutrients? Because...
Yeah, that is what... And that might have been happening. So that might be the natural situation. So that is absolutely true. And then, so... Yeah, exactly. So I had another thing, but yeah... So we don't know. Oh yeah, that is the other thing. If this would be happening and we would think this is a natural state, then we have to be very careful with the blue economy. Because now we are thinking, okay, we put all these farms out of the North Sea to culture algae, to culture shellfish, but there is a limit. And the limit is partly determined by the carrying capacity, that's partly determined now general in nutrients, but now mainly by phosphate. So we have to be, if we do end the phosphate reduction and we increase our blue economy efforts, that will certainly then have an impact on the remaining, say, natural
population
system. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, it's always that if you listen to a biological professor, then yeah, there are all kinds of limits and all kinds of influences that are always going in the wrong direction. And this is a hall full of engineers, and they're always optimistic about the future because they're going to solve it. But it always seems that everything you try to solve will create another biological problem. So
not even biological. It could also be another societal problem. So yeah. I think that's also so my call before the last slide is. These are the challenges. We cannot look only from. We cannot look for sectoral solutions. We can only do it together with all the sectors involved.
But if you look, if we forget the climate change, it's kind of a lost situation anyhow because the temperature will probably rise. What is the most important threat to the Waddenzee at this moment, except the climate change, where engineers could help?
I think infrastructure. Yeah, if you see how much money is going in, so also all the dams and dikes and the thing is that, and then infrastructure maybe even on land, because what you see is probably when the pressure goes up on land, like agriculture or harbors or anything like that, then the solution is always found seawards. Yeah? We see harbors not retracting, we see harbors expanding. So maybe if we could find solutions for that and solutions for things like dredging. That is also the amount of sediment that we are dredging each year and just moving it 10 meters further and then...
That's disturbance.
Yeah.
But did you have to keep it in the Waddenzee?
They keep it in the Waddenzee because it's cheaper to keep it in the Waddenzee. Oh, okay. Because every mile you go
It was better if they throw it outside the Waddenzee?
It would better if there would not be a disturbance at all. So maybe if we could go to, for example, technical solutions could be how to develop the transport to the island.
So make a bridge. So if you make a bridge, then you're happy. The engineering solution. No more dredging.
You know, but you're already filling in. But to have a technical solution would have a less ecological footprint. Maybe a bridge is the end point. I don't know yet because I'm not a technician, but having the things that we presently do, having make the footprint smaller, and I think you're already doing a lot of that work.
Thank you. So I give the audience a last chance.
Yeah, I wonder if there isn't already a solution in place. You have the marker Wadden, and it seems to be an enormous success, and that's done by engineers, by dressing companies, etc. I think it's quite easy to maintain the level of the ground at the Waddenzee. What's your opinion about that?
No, there is no tide. I've been to the Markerwadde last week, so I'm watching. There is no tide in the Markerwadde. So, and what I understood, being there, I didn't do any research, is that the basic idea was to have it in place also to reduce this steering up by the wind of this layer of sediment, of slushy sediment. And what I understood is the size that it is now is probably too small to have that impact. But the thing is that you, for each square meter, you have to make a decision. And in this case, there was a dead bottom and there was nothing there. But what I see in Waddenzee, for example, people are building artificial salt marshes and saying that's new nature, which is true, but there was also old nature. So I think we have to be very careful and make very visible solutions and not be aware what we are destroying at exactly the same time.
And I think that was the last question. Then I want to thank you again for your inspiring speech. And like you said, we will try to keep up the good work. And it's good to have some input from the biology side that we don't do the wrong things. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.